Everybody on Wall Street's talking about AI, which means there's lots of noise, and retail investors need a proper guide to investing in AI that disregards all the hype and gets down to brass tacks. That's what we're going to present today. So we're going to talk about why AI now, and we're going to look at three focus areas, and there's a lot to cover. So this will probably be a multi-part overview. And this is going to build on over a decade of research that we've been doing into AI, which really started around the time that we noticed NVIDIA taking off. This was back in November of 2016. We published this piece, The Artificial Intelligence Stock That Rocked Wall Street. That wasn't too long after we invested in NVIDIA. And we saw the promise of AI such that we decided to go out and learn as much as possible about it. So I spent several years traveling around the world, meeting with AI startups in various places. We published 57 articles, over 85,000 words on AI startups. And the purpose of that was twofold. First of all, when you go down to Silicon Valley and you want to speak to some of the most premier AI startups and get the founder in a room, that's very difficult when you're not TechCrunch. But if you go to places like Russia or Saudi Arabia, Indonesia, where they do have some pretty notable AI talent, these individuals are very eager to speak. So I would talk to founders, tell them, listen, this is all off the record. Let's just have a conversation and you'll get to see what we publish before it gets published. So they would tell us everything. And we were then using that information to pass to VC, so a scouting business model, but we dropped that in favor of the retail investing business model that we have today. So we're going to take a lot of that research that we did, and we're going to couple it with some more research that we came across from a firm called Spear Invest. So this woman here, Ivana Delevska, or Aunt Ivana, she seems to be going down the path of Kathy Wood in regards to her focus on investing in disruptive technologies. And some of the research that her firm is publishing is very good. One piece here, you can see AI data center value chain. We produced several videos around that. We'll talk about that. And the piece we're going to look at today, this artificial intelligence primer, you can pull that up from their website and read through it, or you can watch this video and we'll do that for you. Now, Ivana has segmented the AI opportunity, I think appropriately, into three layers: hardware, data infrastructure, and applications. And she believes that the hardware opportunity is significantly larger and broader than what's incorporated into expectations, though she doesn't believe that the upside there will be as dramatic as possibly in the data layer, where everything is being underappreciated when it comes to value. Now, she says this: we believe the key to differentiation in the application layer will be access to proprietary data. Absolutely. We say that all the time. AI algos are only as good as the data that you feed them. So why AI now? Well, this rather interesting paper came out in 2017 titled Attention is All You Need, and Wired recently wrote this piece on 8 Google employees invented modern AI. Here's the inside story. So this idea of a deep learning architecture known as the Transformer really propelled AI into the limelight. And you can see here these waves described by Spear. So the first wave, predictive. This is when AI was learning perception and inference. It could recognize images, understand speech, recommend a video or an item to buy. And these early NLP models, we wrote a lot about this, researched a lot of the companies involved. They were only able to perform simple search and image recognition with less than 100 million parameters. Well, now the parameters are in the trillions. It's rather remarkable. Second wave of AI here, generative AI. This is what you've all been hearing a lot about. It could generate text, images, video, code, or even fold proteins. And the next wave that we ought to be preparing for is the robotics and industrial digitalization wave, where you have robots, avatars, digital twins, where AI interacts with the physical world. Now, most of the applications to date have been a version of productivity improvement. For example, asking AI to create imagery on demand. So, as an example, I said, AI, please provide a picture of an attractive woman showing me her hands. And the reason that I said that, you'll see here in a second, and it showed me these two individuals that would look like Photoshopped content creators or influencers. And you notice how the hands of the woman on the left are blurred and the hand on the right, that's actually quite good. So I simply asked AI, please produce me a picture of many hands, and this is what it shows me. And you can see a classic problem that AI has with hands. Look at some of these claws. They don't even make sense. So for whatever reason, it's rather spooky. It's almost as if you're in some sort of a dream state looking at some of these images. AI still has a ways to go before it can become imperceptible from stock imagery such as that produced by, you know, big stock photo or Adobe. So when it comes to hardware, you've probably heard of GPUs. They're what made NVIDIA the largest company in the world. CPU, central processing unit, these have been the dominant data center processor over the past cycle, and they're a serial processor. That's what Intel inside, that's where Intel made their bread and butter. They process one instruction at a time. Now, the compute requirements for generative AI increased exponentially the need for parallel processing, and this is what made GPUs, graphic processing units. These are a parallel processor originally used for computer graphics, and they're now the core processor for AI. And what's interesting about NVIDIA is that they had this strong growth well before the 2023 breakout. You can see here, pre-generative AI, they were enjoying 40% compound annual growth rate. I think when we first invested, it was a skate to where the puck will be situation where less than 10% of the revenues was from GPUs. Now it's over 80%. Quite interesting, this comment here. NVIDIA's H100 is comprised of 35,000 parts and nearly 1 trillion transistors in combination. It weighs 70 pounds, takes a robot to build, and takes a supercomputer to test a supercomputer. So truly some remarkable hardware being produced by NVIDIA. But what's interesting is when you look at the forecasts here. So on the left, you can see NVIDIA data center revenues versus the data center market. So now they're pretty much the data center market, but look at how the market for data center hardware takes off there. And NVIDIA's market share is expected to fall. So look at, you know, it's somewhere around 80% right now. Well, that's going to go down as there are competing solutions and more viable substitutes for companies looking for hardware. So this becomes a question of valuing NVIDIA. We did a piece on that that's certainly worth watching. And when we look at NVIDIA's other bits, so the idea there is we say, well, you need to make hay while the sun shines. What are you going to use all this cash that's coming into your coffers for? And it would be their other segments, which frankly aren't looking overly promising. But one that's emerged recently, and Spear has highlighted that here, is networking. So look at NVIDIA's, this would have been last year Q3 networking run rate, and that's actually made available now. They broke that out in their financials. We talked about that recently. And there's a reason that they did that, and I think it's to show that they're a formidable player in that space. And Spear says here, as GPU performance has significantly improved, the bottlenecks are in bandwidth, memory, etc. So networking hardware, for example, the connectivity between chips. And they say that these tangential markets, although not as large as the compute layer, are meaningful in size and can offer similar upside in terms of growth. For example, cooling represents 40% of a data center's energy consumption. So if you can figure out a better cooling solution, then perhaps you could grow those revenues quite quickly. Now, we did a piece based on a research paper that Spear produced titled Data Center Stocks, quite simply, 37 stocks benefiting from AI data centers. And that gives you a bit of a mix. But what did Spear invest in? Well, of those 37 names, they invested in five, and you can see them here. So these five names make up 28% weighting in their ETF. You have NVIDIA, AMD commanding the lion's share of that weighting. Then you have Marvell, Arista, and Invent. We may take a holistic look at their ETF in the future. But what we did do is drill into Arista Networks, ANET, and Marvell, MRVL, in both of these two pieces. What we found is that for Arista, they have heavy customer concentration risk. You can see that here on this slide. The top chart there shows their revenue growth over time. Look how strong that is, right? You can't be disrupting unless without strong revenue growth. So you can't say, I'm a big BSD in AI hardware and then not have revenue growth. And if we back out Microsoft and Meta, two of their largest clients that made up nearly 40% of revenues in 2023, you still see that spike in the bottom chart. That's with Microsoft and Meta backed out. So that's a very good sign for Arista. So it shows demand for their hardware. Now look at Marvell. One of the problems that we find when looking at these companies that all the pundits out there and the instant analysts want to ascribe AI stock label to is that they're often doing lots of other things. You see Marvell is doing quite a bit of stuff here, and look at how these various segments have just collapsed when it comes to revenue growth last quarter. They say non-data center end markets expected to bottom in first half. Well, doesn't matter how strong their data center segment is growing, if their other segments are taking away from that growth, then you just end up with par. So this actually points to something that's very important. We see companies like Poet or some of these other nano or micro caps out there talking about how they do all this great stuff in AI. First of all, absolutely no pre-revenue bullshit. You're either selling something or you're not. And if you are selling something, you better have positive gross margins, right? We're not in the business of funding charities. $10 million per annum to get in the club. That's what we expect. That's meaningful revenues. Pre-revenue hardware companies, honestly, they're the worst thing. Just stay the hell away from those. Revenue growth is always ground truth of what's going on in a company. And no small companies, no over-the-counter shit. So when you're looking at even legitimate firms, don't overpay because valuations are often going through the roof because of AI hype, and they usually always revert back to the mean. Have a simple valuation method that you can calculate yourself. We have the simple valuation ratio, market cap divided by annualized revenue. And watch closely for red flags. Our methodology, and we'll put a link to that in the description of this video, talks about all this stuff. It's a living document that we've been evolving over the years that we've been researching technology companies. So we're going to have some future hardware pieces coming out on Invent Electric. Why is Spear holding them? Vertiv, they're said to be the leader in cooling, and they're extremely hyped ex-SPAC, so we really want to be giving them a lot of scrutiny. And then Intel, a lot of people have been asking us about this. Can this IBM-like company become relevant again? And if you're a paying subscriber and you have questions about anything that I'm talking about today, reply to any email we've sent you and we'll provide answers to those. Now, when we look at the three areas that Spear has pointed to, the hardware layer, data layer, and application layer, they say, regarding hardware, we do not expect outsized moves, 100% plus upside going forward, but they still think there's attractive opportunities there for upward estimate revisions. Data infrastructure, they say AI is a data problem, correct? And we are just in the early innings of data companies seeing an inflection. So that's an area to watch. And then the application layer, they said, is expected to be the largest total addressable market. That's meshes well with what McKinsey says, but it's also the most crowded and competitive space. This sentence here, the incumbents have large installed bases and access proprietary data, which provides them a significant advantage. So as McKinsey had said, they expect a lot of the existing AI companies that were there before this third wave, or let's say the second wave, those firms are going to benefit. Now, when we think about the data layer, that's what we're going to move into next, right? We talked about hardware. We want to talk about data. Forget about data hardware and focus on data software, all right? And this diagram here from Spear and HashiCorp spells out pretty well the evolution of traditional solutions into cloud native solutions. You can see how you used to have relational database systems. So these are what I cut my teeth on in the first half of my career in software startups. These are moving to cloud native solutions. You see they mentioned some names, Snowflake, Databricks, MongoDB, message queuing. That's going to streaming. So the idea there is that you're analyzing the data as quick as it's being produced so you can make decisions very quickly. Confluent works on that. We happen to be invested in Confluent. And you have hardware security that's now moving to networking and security. So you have, you know, names like CrowdStrike. And then look on the right there, that's Datadog, application performance monitoring. So Spear put together this rather nifty diagram, which shows the data companies that we'll want to look at next in various segments. They start out with cloud service providers. These are the core of the AI value chain because they offer the necessary infrastructure, computing power, and storage capability so that anyone with money can start developing some AI applications. These three hyperscalers, they vary in their degrees of exposure, and we're going to talk about that in our next video, this idea of a cash cow versus a rising star. But you didn't come to invest in everything with Google. That's a flaw. We often see pundits say, well, Google's a play on robotics. Google's a play on cloud computing. Google's a play on everything. Well, Google largely is a play on ad spend at the moment. But just some concluding thoughts on hardware from Spear. So memory, bandwidth, and energy consumption, they say, are key pressure points. A big misconception is that GPUs are replacing CPUs, and ultimately every device is going to have some form of accelerated computing. That's a term that in the context of Marvell, you'd want to watch that video. We talk about that there. And over time, the cost of running models will significantly decrease, which means that it's more feasible for additional competitors. The moat becomes smaller. Now, some concluding thoughts from our side. AI hardware is certainly the most visible segment. We're going to have some follow-up pieces. Make sure you subscribe because we have a lot of great content coming out on investing in AI as a follow-up to this video. We're going to have some follow-up pieces on some more obscure names talked about today. The AI data layer presentation is up next. We'll get that out fairly quickly in the coming days. We're going to look at companies like Snowflake and Databricks. They're private. Very interesting stuff. And of course, our third part of this series will be on the AI application layer. You can see some of these companies here on the right. We'll talk about startups versus incumbents and talk a little bit about the various technologies and opportunities there. So I'm going to go ahead and leave you with this great presentation. We did a list of 37 data center stocks, and you can sort of go down that rabbit hole. Make sure to subscribe so you don't miss out on any of the coming videos we're going to do on investing in AI. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this today.